think it's better now if you didn't.
Stereotypical Asian parents, where it's like, oh, you need to go to a four-year university, like, Mount Sinai Community College is just the reputation of Mount, or community colleges in general.
They see it as a failure.
They're not as good. Oh, you're going to go there and it's going to be the end of your life, or it's going to be, you're going to be stuck there. You know, you'd be stuck there for college and never be able to transfer. And then,
why did you go to community college? You know, what's wrong with you?
You'll be mixed around these people that don't know what they're doing with their lives, and then you'll go and it's a place to die. Your hopes and dreams are all dead if you go to junior college, and nobody will like you because you went to junior college.
So my name is Linda Diaz, and I've been at Mount SAC now for 34 years. I think this will be my 35th year. And I think, and I love my job. I still love my job after all this time, and it doesn't seem like that long at all. But the joy that I get from helping students reach their goals trumps everything. You know, it's just so selfishly satisfactory. And then seeing the students succeed and move on, bachelor's, law school, whatever they want to do. And it's a very rewarding job. So I'm very pro community college. I'm a community college transfer myself. And I find that students who come to community college have a second chance.
Yeah.
Sometimes they didn't get admitted to their first choice school, or there's the usual about saving money, but there's so much more of a personal touch, as you were saying, at a community college than there is going directly into a university. So we here, particularly in honors and even in just counseling in general, want to be guides to help students be more competitive to reach the school of their choice. Just a little bit of statistics before we get into things.
Of course.
So through the honors program, for example, at UCLA, the typical transfer rate is about 23%.
Wow.
Out of the general population. Out of honors, it's now 78%.
Wow.
A huge difference. Now, it used to be more like 89, 90% success rate out of honors, but the problem is students apply to the same 12 majors. And you can't do that and have a huge, so 4.0s are turned down sometimes. Our students go everywhere. UCLA is the number one, Berkeley is the number two. Irvine is quickly catching up with Berkeley because of all of the agreements that we have. So we're just really proud of the whole program. We have an agreement with UCLA. It's called TAP, Transfer Alliance Program, and if we can abbreviate anything, we will. So there's TAP in different contexts, but this one is for UCLA.
Yeah.
It is 15 units of honors by the end of the student's last spring before they transfer, minimum 3.2 GPA, which is not necessarily realistic, but for most majors, it's going to be about a 3.6 or higher, or 3.5 or higher. And they're given priority consideration, not guaranteed, but a priority consideration. And what that means is, say they're a psychology major, and the typical psych major is going to be a 3.8 admission. Yeah. If they have their 15 units of honors and they have a 3.6, they will be just as competitive as a 3.8 student.
Wow.
So that's really a good
thing. So the 3.8 is the student right out of high school, or is that...
Out of transfer. Yeah. Out of high school, it would be 4 point something.
Wow.
Yeah. And we are a Hispanic serving institution.
Of course.
And one of the reasons that we have the agreement with UCLA is because we have a broad ethnic population.
Yeah.
And so UCLA is looking to increase their underrepresented students, and we are the one of the primary schools
Feeding
that allow
schools.
Them
nice.
Mm-hmm, that allow them to do it. We also have an agreement with UC Irvine, which is fantastic. I can't think of anything else to say other than that word. It is called Honors to Honors. Students have to have a 3.7 by the end of their last fall before they transfer. Be well prepared for their major. With that, they are guaranteed admission, guaranteed housing, guaranteed research, guaranteed stipend for that research, and guaranteed priority registration. I just finished the list of students. I submitted 51 names, which doesn't sound like a lot. It is a lot of students who qualify for honors to honors. And that's just, and usually that means full ride financial aid. Here at Mount SAC, we're kind of located where we're very fortunate. We've got Cal Poly, we've got Fullerton, we've got San Bernardino.
Yeah.
We've got LA, we've got Irvine, not so far from SD. So we're really kind of fortunate here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So how does the private schools differ from the UCs? Because they aren't the state schools.
Right.
But how do you push students towards private schools?
Oh, sure. For private schools, the option usually comes because of money for the public schools, but we also have agreements with private schools. And we always try to create a carrot, like they get priority registration, or maybe there is a scholarship that goes along with it or whatever. Yeah. But we, in our orientations, we always talk about other schools to apply broadly. Because the thought is, I must apply to Berkeley or UCLA, and that's about it. But that's not the best thing to do.
Yeah.
No. So the private schools, we're so fortunate here. We've got the Claremont Colleges.
Wow.
We've got Laverne. We've got Pepperdine. We've got the Redlands. And students now, many of them are applying. USC is another one that many of our students go to. And now students are looking to go to the East Coast, because many times now the East Coast becomes more less expensive. We have agreements. Myself and my coworker Randy, we both do the advising and counseling, and we've both been here for so long that, you know, we try to keep up to date, and we have students that go all over, so it's really a good thing. There always is that stigma.
Yeah.
You know, why did you go to community college? You know, what's wrong with you? And they face that stigma, but it is amazing that the stories,
yeah.
The anecdotes of when they leave here saying, this is the best choice I could have made, because it allowed me to grow as a leader,
of course,
to be involved, to feel part of a community, and to become competitive to go to the school of my choice. But there still is that stigma. We have had 1.8 students out of high school come here, and this light bulb kind of goes on, and they leave here and they go to UCLA or they go to Berkeley, or students who have been homeless, and then the valedictorians who come here because it's just more cost effective, or they want to participate in choir or sport, but they still have to go through that little, because it's, they are 9 times out of 10 criticized by someone. But they get over that. This is a place where they can find a community. The universities like transfer students. They fill in the spaces of people who have dropped out. But the biggest thing that the universities tout is that transfer students graduate at the same rate and the same GPA as native students.
Wow.
So that's huge. So it's a matter of, you spend 4 years at the university, or you spend 2 years at a community college, and you're at the same junior level as everybody else that your friends are at the university. So some students take longer because they want to do a minor or things of that nature. But traditionally, it's the same graduation rate and the same GPA as native students.
Yeah.
So there's no, the stigma is there, but the ability of the student to do just as well at the university is there. In my experience, the word stuck isn't really...
Yeah. Well, they're just a little... Yeah.
Yeah. They need to talk to someone, and that's why we are here.
Yeah.
To help them, and if it takes them 3 years because maybe their math level wasn't there or their major requires so much more than other majors do, like you with a bio major.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. You have a lot ahead of you. So it can take maybe a little bit longer, but maybe a year longer, depending on the major and the school. However, that student can be more competitive because of things like being involved in a forensics team or a choir. Yeah. But the other thing that honors can give a student here at Mount SAC is that, and from RCC or any most yeah. of the community colleges, is we have students present their research at different research conferences. Wow. And so that is a huge thing that they can put on any resume. Also, through the conference that we have at UC Irvine, they can be published. So you could be a sophomore and you're applying to junior level, and you could have presented at a research conference and been published. Yeah. How many undergrads can say that? Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm Caroline. I go to Cal State Fullerton. I went to Mount SAC, competed in track and field, did pole vault and discus, and now I'm at Fullerton getting my BS degree in kinesiology.
Very nice. My name is Philippe. I went to Mount SAC and did my time here, graduated, competed in pole vaulting, and went to University of Oregon for my first year of college. Didn't work out. So now I'm back.
I was pretty average, 3.5.
That's average.
I mean,
kind of cutting muscle.
I'm a little average for where I came from. I came from a lot of high school, and so 3.5 is pretty. It's okay. It's okay.
Yeah, that's what. Yeah.
Yeah.
I totally get it. How about you?
I took the more sports approach in my high school. So I went to Temple City High School. I graduated with 3.13 GPA, which isn't, you know, great or terrible. I won AP, AP, and then I spent 4 hours of track.
What did your parents first think when you said, I want to go to Mount SAC?
They didn't like it. Stereotypical Asian parents, when it's like, oh, you need to go to a four-year university, like, Mount SAC is a community college, it's just the reputation of Mount, or community colleges in general, they don't have a good rep. But they don't realize how much smarter it is, because I always explain the first 2 years of any college is the same. It's just GEs. They're lower divs, and so you could take that anyway and it transfers fine. I chose to go to Mount SAC anyways, and it saved them a whole bunch of money. So then they ended up being happy about it.
Asian family, so we kind of had one of those, like, called mianzi, which is face in Chinese. So my dad had my mom had the biggest problem with it, but then at the end she was just like, okay, you go do what you need to do. But I told them the logic. I was just like, listen, general education, I still want to figure out what I'm doing for the first 2 years. It's a good idea for me to go. Then my dad sat me down. He was just like, I think it's better not if you didn't.
Wow.
I think it's better if you didn't, yeah.
I actually committed to Fullerton, Cal State Fullerton, but thinking more about it, I wanted to compete. And so I just decided to stick to go to Mount SAC.
Oh,
yeah. Yeah, I mean, on average, a college student changes their major like 6 or 7 times. And it's very costly if you do that at a four-year university as opposed to a community college where the classes are like 90% cheaper, and it's just so much easier to maneuver your way around the courses than doing that at a university.
I had a couple other options. I applied to USC Rice University because Ryan recommended it to me. ASU, University of Tennessee, because one of our Olympic athletes was coaching there. And then I applied to University of Oregon. That was my own personal choice because that was the biggest track program. I got into that easy. I walked onto the team. I had a stress fracture. So the thing was, I spent $50,000 at Oregon for 1 year. And I felt like I wasted my time.
Wow.
Yeah. That was the biggest shock to me. Going out of state, spending $50,000, you know, and still trying to pay that off, and knowing that I had that student debt, that was the biggest shock to me. Because I felt like I wasted my time because I didn't know what I was doing. You know, the facility was great. I saw a lot of new experiences. I met a lot of great people. But at the end of the day, for my education, for my pole vaulting, was it worth it? I wouldn't say it was worth $50,000 and the constant pressure of knowing I didn't do anything with it.
I had priority because I was an athlete. I did hear about the honors program, but I didn't do the honors program because they give you priority for honor classes, and I didn't need it. I didn't. Wouldn't have transferred too much to the 4 year in my case.
So I came back, and I had to come back for 2 years because, you know, transferring the credits and transferring those somewhere else was a huge ordeal. So that's why I recommended, okay, you know what, going to a two-year college and getting your general education done, figuring out what you want to do, and having a clear idea of who you are, you'll have a lot of experiences in university, yeah. But we had guys that transferred in that they were juniors, and they still had that dorm room experience that everybody craves.
Did you feel like you missed out on the college experience going here for 2 years?
I mean, it's crossed my mind, but I mean, I feel like it's never too late because I plan to transfer in 2 years. You know, if you're on track of your courses and everything, then you're gonna transfer in 2 years, and then you could have your 2 years of a university. And I think that's perfectly fine. Honestly, for me, I like change, so having 2 years in Outside and then another 2 years at a different school and then hopefully grad school, it's a good transition because it gets to experience different campuses and different lifestyles at different colleges.
Not at all. First off, you don't want a freshman 50. Second off, you don't want a freshman diet, okay? I swear to God, I was eating cup ramen for there was a week there where Thanksgiving weekend, I didn't think it was worth the money to come back home. And everything closed. Everybody went home for Thanksgiving because of the white people area in Oregon. So, you know, I had a lot of ramen and a lot of chips that weekend and not a lot of real food. So that was not the best. So that's number one. Do I feel like I missed out? No, because you can go anywhere and party. You know, we had our team out here at track, just so long as you have the right social group, you'll have the parties to go to. It might be a little bit different. It might be the difference between partying at a house or partying at a dorm. But hey, you know, it's all the same. Somebody has an apartment. And generally, that's going to be the better party because the dorm, you got the RA on your butt, okay? For your frats, no. Why would you miss out on your frats? You're here for 2 years just to clean up your general education. And when you go, you can do whatever the hell you want. You can go get student dorms if you're a junior transferring in because you're technically a freshman. They'll let you do student dorms. I had juniors that were there. I had seniors that were in dorms. And then the frats, they'll let you in no matter what you are. But remember, you'll get hazed, you know, and you might get hazed harder because you're older. So, yeah, so do I feel like I missed out on anything? No. If anything, I feel like I had a better experience just to mix and match, you know, between a university and a college.
People just downing Mountainside because it's a community college or because it's a two-year program that I feel like for people who aren't very financially stable, mm-hmm. community college is one of the best ways to go because the courses are a lot cheaper, but the people who, you know, talk about community college and down community colleges, those are the people who have enough money to pay for a four-year university. So, I mean, you can't really compare that type of person to a person who needs financial help and goes to community college. Granted, there are people who have money and come here. It might be that their grades weren't good enough for them to get to a university, or I don't know, the situation, there's a whole variety of situations. But for the most part, people come to Mountainside because it's cheap and because it's an easy transition from community college to a four-year. But the stigma kind of keeps people from coming here, and it's unfortunate because, you know, it's just like at a four-year, if you're not on top of your stuff, then you could get kicked out of the campus for not having a high enough GPA or something.
Oh, wow. Did you feel like you, how was it pressing that?
College more than high school, just because I get to plan my own schedule. But it forces me to be more responsible because I have to search up the classes that I want to take and the times that I want to take them at, which I prefer because, yeah, that makes me more responsible. It makes me, like, on top of my stuff.
Things that people said about junior college, they're not as good. Oh, you're gonna go there and it's gonna be the end of your life, or you're gonna be stuck there. You know, you'll be stuck there for your college and never be able to transfer, and then you'll be mixed around these people that don't know what they're doing with their lives, and then you'll go and it's a place to die. Your hopes and dreams are all dead if you go to junior college, and nobody will like you because you went to junior college. That's the whole myth and legend. Everybody kind of looks down on junior colleges. I don't understand that. Because a junior college is a very respectable place, you know, for track and field and a smaller sport such as pole vaulting that doesn't get a lot of publicity, actually going to a junior college would be one of the best places to go. Because they'll have some of the best coaches that will teach and coach, and they'll get higher salary for it. So you'll have Olympic athletes there. You'll have people who used to be, you know, pole vault stars there. May not have necessarily been Olympic athletes, but were in the elite world. So that's the sports part of it. On the academic part of it, why would you, it doesn't make sense to me why this is a place to die, because you have people that come here and know, it depends on you, really. You have people who come here and know exactly what they want to do with their life, and then you have people who just come here because college is a normal part of our life and we need it now. Which group do you want to associate with? Which one do you want to figure it out? Are you going to go party with the people that don't know what's going on, stay here for 4 years and be like, I should probably go get a bachelor's degree? Or are you going to go talk to a counselor, get your academic stuff on lockdown, and then go party, you know, and then have a 2-3 year plan where you transfer out in 2 years, get it done in a year and a half with summer, and then you transfer out and go have big college, big university party, you know? So there's a lot of stigma on community colleges aren't as good as universities. Do I think that's true? No, because there are some community colleges that have very great programs, and they'll get you to be nurse, firefighter, you know, it depends on what you want to do. And then I really think, though, for the people that want to go to uni and they're just like, oh, you, college is just dumb, college is just a place where people go to die, I think college, community college, is a great gateway to get into the university that you want into. You know, you might get accepted and you'll pay $50,000, kind of be confused for the first 2 years, or you can go to community college, have a lot of fun, spend a hell of a lot less money, you know? So.
Do you regret coming here at all?
Not at all. I would recommend anyone go to community college. It doesn't have to be Mount Sac, but I love Mount Sac.
Yeah.
So I know a bunch of high school friends who can ask for advice and just like, you know, if you don't know what you're going to do exactly in the 4 years, then go to Mount Sac, experience different classes at a cheaper price, and then transfer out. And plus, once you go to a community college, it's like your GPA resets.
College are pushed in the right way with regards to the class material, yes. Challenged and pushed the right way with teachers, I think the teachers did a very great job of making things very clear and working through the material slowly. And honestly, one of the great things about community colleges, there's a lot of people who use Rate My Professor a lot more people than uni.
Yeah.
I was at Oregon and trying to find my professor on Rate My Professor, no reviews. Nobody can tell you unless you had somebody else in the dorm was just like, oh yeah, that's a bad teacher or whatever. With my professor on community college, where everybody's just like, oh, I hate this guy, I hate this guy, I hate this guy. And then you get that like 10th review that says, he's a good guy, do the work and you'll be fine. You can trust kind of that review. Challenge academically, I think that's a selection of your classes. I don't think anything really prepares you to go to any other school. I went to Oregon, and I went to the orientation. Everything was all beautiful. It's August. Oregon's gorgeous. It's crisp, 70 degrees, so it's not too hot, not too cold. And then winter hit, and we had 180 days of rain. Do you think community college would have prepared for that? That kind of depression that you kind of go into? It's not even a rain that comes straight down. It's a heavy mist. So if you have an umbrella, you're still getting blown in the face. So you kind of, every single day, you kind of have to admit to yourself, okay, I'm wet, that's it, and then just go on with your day. So academically, on the other hand, I think the way that you prep, because you can cheat through any class, let's be honest here. You can just take the study guide, cram the night before, and kind of get a passing grade to finish out. But if you study right, and you go to a university knowing what you want to do, I think you'll be fine. You'll be prepared. You'll be prepared for what comes at you, rather than, I know exactly what I'm going into.
Rowe, Principal Riverside Poly High School.
Okay. And then from there, just tell me this yourself.
Okay, so I'll share with you my education pathway.
Yeah.
My education pathway, went to a bunch of different high schools growing up. I was bounced around in the system, had some challenges growing up. Ended up at Ramona, ended up graduating at Elsinore High School. From that point, spent a year, kind of took off and coached volleyball in some different places, and then decided that probably was not something I wanted to do with the rest of my life. I was working in the restaurant business at the time. So I decided to go, did not have the grades coming out of high school. High school were very turbulent years for me.
Yeah.
So I went to Mount San Jacinto Junior College.
Nice.
And at that time, they had a Menifee campus, which they now has become super big out there towards Temecula.
Yeah.
and had a phenomenal experience. Probably had some of the best teachers I've ever had, because every teacher that I had there was actually a practitioner that was in the field. So it was very real, hands-on, and really gave me a love for political science as well as philosophy. After MSJC, I went from a ridiculous GPA in high school to a 3.9.
Wow.
Coming out of there. Got accepted to Berkeley. A lot of schools all over the place. Ended up going back to a school called Juniata College, which is almost the equivalent of like a University of Redlands, but about 20 miles south of Penn State University, where I could play volleyball. Because back at that point, some of the colleges that were just under the D1 status were just starting with boys programs. Played volleyball there, did not like being in Pennsylvania, came back to California, and at that time was working for the Clinton Gore campaign. And in the Inland Empire, ended up going to CBU more from a logistics standpoint, okay, because it was close, and they allowed me a lot of what I was doing on the campaigns. They allowed me to do an independent study. So a lot of the stuff that I was doing, I was getting college credit for without having to be on campus every single day. So I got my bachelor's in philosophy and political science from Cal Baptist University. Decided at that point that I was getting ready to go to law school, at which point my wife and I at the time lost a son. I was substitute teaching at that time in order to be able to kind of put food on the table.
Yeah.
Came back to the classroom a couple weeks after our son Tanner passed, and the kids read for me a book called Love You Forever. And as the ultimate children's book. And from that point on, I realized education is where I want to be. So I ended up getting my master's in education, emphasis curriculum and instruction, and then went on and pursued a doctorate degree at the University of Laverne in organizational leadership.
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
So you got to do something at the end of the day, especially with myself coming from nothing. I know what it's like to have nothing. So you spend most of your life comparing yourself to other people with whom you perceive to have things. And that's a very dangerous way of kind of establishing your own value, because where there would be people that would be arrogant per se, that's nothing more than masked insecurity. Yeah. Because if they think they're better than you, somewhere down the line, they believe there's somebody better than them. One of the biggest myths told is that you go to college to learn how to make money. You don't. You go to college to get educated. Is that important? Absolutely. The more educated you are, the more you're aware of some of those opportunities and arteries that you can go down. I think when you look at our country and you look at the way our education system is set up, I see a lot of kids coming out of, they go out there, they go to the big name school, they come back, and in that private moment, it's like, well, now what do I do?
Yeah.
And what I'm seeing is, as a country, we are not at a loss for innovators and people who are creative. I mean, there's not a lack of ideas going around. What there is a lack of is teaching those folks basically the skill of being an entrepreneur, meaning, so if here's the idea, I'm going to invent electricity, that never would have moved anywhere unless JP Morgan hadn't stepped in and actually financed that. So how do we teach the process of entrepreneurship, where that relentlessness of being able to take a product, an idea, a concept, bring it to market? It's those things in life that you come on, and you can make either a choice or you can make a decision. But you can't do both at the same time. Every time most people come through, they make a decision in life, it's based on past experience.
Yes.
But very few times in your life do you come across situations where you have to make a true choice. And a true choice is made from a place of absolute nothingness. You don't have any background. So the first time you go to get married, it will be a choice to get married. If you fumble that and get married again, it's a decision at that point.
Yeah, yeah.
And what he talked about was, it's those choices that when you think about it, all of the risk involved. So one of the biggest misnomers about achieving one's goal is this role of fear. And we look at fear and we say, no fear, fear not, all this other nonsense. And what he says is, no fear, K-N-O-W. Because the one thing you're promised is that on the other side of that fear, there will always be growth. You're going into an area you've never been before. So by the very nature of that, your idea of what's possible all of a sudden begins to move this way, and it gets wider, and the lens gets wider. Mm-hmm. We have a lot of kids who are going through the motions that are performing very well in the classroom, and we've talked about this before. Well, they may be performing well, not learning much, but they may be performing well based on the system that we have. Some that are living somebody else's life. versus living their mm-hmm. own. And you have folks that want to go out there and, you know, you, people always say, you know, how's life treating you? Well, no, I'm treating life well, but I'm not letting things happen to me versus I'm in a state of creating the things that I'm committed to. And it really becomes, there's two, let me turn this down real quick. There's two life philosophies. There are people in life that operate from responsibility. There are people in life that operate from victim. We all know the victims of the world. These are people that no matter, you know, what's going on, they've got a story to tell about why they're not doing what they're doing. Or worse yet, when they see you out doing what you're doing, they're going to be the first to make you wrong about it. You know, it's like the old pot of boiling water with crabs. You know, the story goes, if you've ever watched it, you know, you'll have this pot of boiling water and there will be a bunch of crabs on the bottom, and then you throw them all into the boiling water. And what do? They're trying to get out. But what's fascinating, if you watch the crabs at the bottom, they realize they can't get out and they're faced with a choice. And what they do is they try and pull the other ones that are getting out back in. And clearly I'm not talking about crabs, but there are people that operate very much to that. When you break the mold and here you are, you know, you got the thing lined up with Cal State Fullerton, you're rocking and rolling, all of a sudden, you know what? I think I'm gonna do the Mount SAC route. I think I'm gonna get better at what I'm doing right now. Take some time to really focus on getting better at this skill, pursue the athletic trainer thing a little bit more and see really where I'm at with that before I make that jump. That doesn't put me two steps behind. That actually puts me two steps ahead, because what I don't want to be is the person coming out of the great name school, congratulations, you had a 4.5, congratulations, you gave a great speech at graduation, and 4 years from now you're sitting there in an empty room going, this is it? This is what I signed up for?
Danielle Sovine, I'm at Riverside Poly, I'm a counselor, and why do I counsel kids? I think because I want to see them be successful in life. So I taught for years, loved it, but it was only one part of their life, and so I wanted to see them as a whole student, where they were going, where they were going to be after graduation and in life in itself. I have been at Poly, oh my gosh, it's going to make me sound old. I have been here 12 years. Almost 13 years at Poly. My job is to advocate for you, whatever you want to do afterwards. Whether that means I'm the rule keeper when it comes to getting into schools, if that means I am the medium between you and your parents, if that means I am talking to a teacher on your behalf because, you know, you are having a bad day or you need help with something, I think my biggest job is to advocate. And that's what I should be doing here every day. So higher education is kind of a broad term. If we think about it, if we're looking just at like a 4-year in a university, you know, Poly on itself is right around 48%, 50% of our seniors go. 2 years is, I think, about 30 or 40 within that secondary part. And then some go to work, some go into the military. It just depends. Most of my students will go to some part of higher education, whether that's a specific like book-based college, or if it's going to be a trade school, or going to work and learning, you know, their industry, their field. It just depends. I think that they see it as a failure. Yeah, and that's a strong word, I know, but because 4-year is such a big deal, because 4-year appears to be the only option, I think if they feel like they have to go to an RCC type junior college that they didn't do well enough in school. And I don't believe that's the case. I think 4-year is preached, and I know that's another big term, but it is really preached because that is the hardest requirements to do. And if you do that, you have all the options in the world. And so I think that's why it's become this big push, maybe not specifically for physically going to the 4-year, but that you have that choice. But they definitely, I mean, I've heard it referred to a lot of different things even when I was in high school about going to RCC was like a continuation of high school. And it's not. It's the opposite. It's going to college. It's getting your education. It's moving on. Yeah. There are a lot of myths when it comes to community college that you're going to go and go to school forever and never get anywhere, that you can't get your classes. Some of them, I mean, every myth is based on some type of truth.
Yeah.
I mean, our community colleges have been highly impacted, and so it has taken a little bit more time. But I think whether it's a community college or a 4-year, the decision on finishing is up to you. If you're at an RCC or a 4-year and you're there to finish, you'll finish. if you're at a four-year university and you're there to, you know, have a good time and hang out, you're not going to finish there either.
Yeah.
So I think the myth that's there is, you know, you don't have the ability to make that second chance or that transfer. But I think that's an individual decision either way. Breaks my heart to have that, especially if that's where my student wants to go. That's where they want to be. And then the money part comes into there. It always breaks my heart that they don't get their dreams. I mean, my job is to advocate. I want them to do whatever they want to do in life. But I know that most schools are affordable. So then I guess my talk would be, okay, why do you feel like you can't afford it? What are we talking about? What are we looking at? What kind of financial aid was available? Did we apply for? Where are we at? And then in the back of my head, can I make the dream come true? And if I can't, that doesn't mean that they're not going to go to UC Davis someday. That doesn't mean that they're not going to finish and continue on. Because truthfully, college is about learning and moving on. Education is about learning and moving on. And it's the end point that counts. So whether I start at a community college or if I go straight to a university, or if I start as a cashier and then move up the line in my job, whatever the end result is where they're successful in life, that's what's important.
Yeah.
I think because it's such a push, and negative or not negative, I think it's a huge push to say, hey, you got to go to a college, you got to go to college, because we want them to have every opportunity.
Yeah.
And so I think the other side of the story is that these are your opportunities, let's have choice. And maybe that's what needs to be preached, is the idea of choice. These are all your choices, so let's aim for them. Because I think what has happened historically in the past is that every student wasn't given that choice to go to a four-year. And so when that changed, we became almost overzealous, that now every student, no matter what, is going there, which is not the truth of it. So I think because historically education is, you know, kept people out of it by not giving opportunities, that we just assume everyone's going to do it. I would love to say education is perfect in the every opportunity every student, but it's not.
It's not.
And I think in two things, like, we have tried to equal the playing field, which is great, but then that goes back to the whole thing, you know, what is equal is always not, you know, right for that person. What is right is always not equal. And so what does that really look like to each individual student? How do we do that for them? I don't know. I mean, I'm trying every day, but I don't know. So what do I do with students who don't want to go to a four-year but are smart and capable?
Yeah. I mean, how does
my encouragement is always to have options. And so when I guide them in class selections, that's what it would be. But in the end, if their choice is to do that, and that's what makes them happy, and that makes them contributing members of society, then that's where they should be.
Yeah.
Because if I go to a four-year, and I don't want to be there, and I get a degree, and I end up in a job in accounting, and I want to be a welder, that's a miserable place to be. I don't want them to have that for the rest of their lives.
Yeah.
So I'm always going to encourage them to have as many options as possible. But when it comes down to it, if they're just like, this is what it is, then that's their choice. I try not to have them dictate that choice as a freshman. I know that sounds silly.
Yeah, no, but they do. They do.
But as between 14 and 18, there's so much growth that goes on that I also don't want a student to pigeonhole themselves. College is more about choice than anything, which I think is beautiful for college because you can choose what you want to do. But the direct guidance and direct selections for classes is not always there. I mean, you can find it, you can Google it, you can pull them up, like, this is what I gotta do. But once you get to college, you have to be a self-learner. You have to be dedicated to finishing. And that kind of goes back to what you asked before. You know, if a kid goes to a community college versus a school, are they wasting their time? Are they gonna get lost? I think you get lost either way.
Yeah.
I think that it's very directed and very specific when you're in high school, because K through 8 is. That's our job. Our job is to get you through high school, to educate you, to be a contributing member of society. And if we do that as a public school system, and that's why we're here, then we've succeeded in that.
Yeah.
But beyond that is your choice. It's your choice to choose college. It's your choice to decide what major, what career you want to go into. And so, fortunate or unfortunately, they have the same thing when it comes to your class selection. It's your choice what you take. I mean, you could go to a four-year and take, you know, underwater basket weaving for four semesters and never finish. You know, but you have to know how to look for stuff. And hopefully K through, you know, 12, we've taught you those skills to look, to know where to look, or to know how to ask those questions. Once they leave, we don't always hear what happens. But ones that have come back, most of them change up what they thought they were going to do when they left here.
Yeah.
Very few will find their passion very early, and very few will stick with that passion and continue. There is that percentage that does it, that they just have a natural knack for something, but not as many as you would think. I see that has changed. Because I will say, it has not always been a situation where you had to declare a major when you went to a school. It was very common to go undecided. It was very common to decide a major and change it within a year, and that was okay. But I have noticed that now, I mean, you have to declare a major. And I mean, just an example, I had a student a couple years ago who wanted to go into engineering, so applied to UCSD and did not get into engineering but got into the school. Okay, so I would think, I'm going to go to that school I declared, and I'll transfer into engineering. That's what I want to do. That's not an option. Like, yeah. If you go in undeclared and you want to get into engineering, they may not have any openings. And actually, when I talked to the counselor there, she says we rarely have openings. So that student would have gone there and never got his major. That's not how college was. It's not what college was about. It was about learning. It was about exploring. It's about trying things out. You know, in any way, shapes, or forms of that, whether educationally or even just being an adult and understanding how to do your own laundry. I mean, that's what college is about. And it's really sad to see that we're very specific in those majors have to be declared to even have a chance of going there. I went undeclared. Half of my colleagues went undeclared. Most of the people I know, you know, back in the day, I'll say I'm not that old, but back in the day went undeclared. It was okay. It was acceptable. And then you figured it out along the way. At some point, I think the system's gonna have to change. It's gonna have to change, yeah. Because I don't think we're doing right by a lot of our kids. Some of our students that are done with high school, they're done with school. And so I'll find that later on they go back and they pick up stuff. Or if they do pursue, you know, education and they haven't completely closed the door on it, and they're refocused and they're doing that they do just fine. And that goes back to, you know, what's my job? Is it really going to school, or is it, you know, helping students become young adults, yeah. And be a part of society? And I think that's my goal. In saying that, I have had kids that have done all kinds of stuff. I have kids that, you know, barely made it through high school, and now, you know, they're a part of a, you know, wonderful company. They're making good money. They have their own cars. They're living. And I think that's a success.
Hi, I'm Diamond Alexander. I'm from Inglewood, California. I'm a first year at Santa Barbara City College, and I am a high jumper, and I redshirt in basketball. It's really cool. If you come here, you really have to like work hard and have discipline, because if you don't, you're gonna fall off. No, I like it here. Like, yeah. I feel like academically, this is the place for me to be. Some of the classes I took in high school prepared me. Like, I took AP Lit, so that kind of like helped me a lot. And I don't know, just like the curriculum in high school is like, it's way different.
Yeah.
It's like, in high school, you could just get by being like doing basics, but you can't hear. My English 70 is like a reading class, and I feel like I'm really not supposed to be in that class. I'm just a bad test taker. So I was like basically half-assing my notes and stuff. So she like told me to meet her in her office, and she's like, I know like you're intelligent, and this book may be boring, but you need to like apply yourself. Like, she's like, why would you just do the basics? Like, why don't you just excel in the class? So they like really want the best for you. They don't want you to just be complacent. They want you to exceed above and beyond.
What happens when you,
if you miss 3 days of class, you get dropped.
Oh wow.
Yeah.
3 days in a semester?
Yeah. You get dropped, like, that's it.
Really?
And then if you get dropped, like, I guess they find you, I'm not sure, but I always go to class, so that won't happen to me. Inglewood's like really big, and like it's a lot of things to do, and family and friends and everything. And then you come here and it's like a whole different scene. Like, it's a small town and it's super expensive, so like I think like that's what we all complain about here. Like, it's so expensive. Well, coming from high school here, like it makes you become responsible. Like, you have to, because you have to do everything on your own. Like, your parents might help you, but they're not gonna go to the grocery store with you. They're do your homework. Like, don't go to that party. You need to study. Like, they're not gonna do that. So it just made me like more mature.
So you learn how to grow up.
Yeah, like you have to, and if you don't, you're gonna fall behind and you're not gonna like succeed here. I'm getting the college experience here.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's like, our football games are like decent. So I mean, it's just how you take it, like, it's your perspective. Like, before I was just like, I hate it here, and like, once you start making friends and like going to games and like hanging out with people, like going to the beach or even like going to like a little kickback, like, it's really nice. And I didn't go to community college like at home. Mm-hmm. There's one, like, it's not in Inglewood, it's called El Camino.
Oh yeah.
And then Southwest, but I didn't go there because I just feel, well, personally, like, I have a friend that went there.
I just didn't like it.
And he is still there, and he's 27. Ooh. Yeah, so I didn't want that to be me. Like, not like knocking him or anything, but I just didn't want to be that person to be like stuck at a community college for so long. And I feel like here, you have to transfer. Like, there's no choice. And if you don't transfer, like, they set you up for a good job. And they have, like, internships and stuff. So, with sports, it's either, like, sometimes they just want to play and then that's it. And, like, some of the coaches have to respect that. But most of the players are like, well, I want to play at the next level. Well, if you want to play at the next level, you have to get your work done.
Yeah.
So, that way, like, we make an ed plan. And every week, we have to do 3 hours of studying in achievement zone. Mm-hmm. And if we don't do those 3 hours, we can't compete or practice. So, like, they set all of us up to succeed, basically. It's just, like, if we take it. Resources everywhere. They send emails for internships. They help you with your resume, your cover letter. Like, they do everything here.
In Yokoyama, work at Mount SAC. Been here 27 years. Also handle the USA National Polo Team Group. No, I've been here at Mount SAC. I've been had a number of jobs as a professor, coach, and then right now I currently handle marketing within the sports formation. I'm the director of the sports formation and also handle marketing a lot of our major events here at Mount SAC.
Nice.
The community and the college have changed significantly through the time I've been here. You know, there's a lot more homes there. This used to be a very, very rural, hidden part of Los Angeles is what I kind of call it. And since that time, we've had a number of roads opened, and it's really become a little bit more urban, but still we maintain a real casual environment here. I think it's not quite urban, still rural here.
It is.
I think people don't realize, as far as coaching goes in this particular sport, I think when you talk about football, baseball, basketball, the top echelon of coaching is at the, you know, Division I or professional levels. Here at track and field, there really is not. I mean, there's a small professional group, but, you know, it's hard to make a living there. And then as far as, like, universities, California Community College teachers and professors are probably in the top 95 percentile in salary. That's what's unusual about this position. As far as for track and field coaching, this is pretty much the top you can get. And the pay is excellent. You know, a lot of our head coaches are making six figures plus.
Actually pretty good.
Also, the benefit packages, you know, for insurance and all that are phenomenal here. And Mount SAC has been very fortunate to be probably one of the top, at the top of the list as far as salaries go in community college. And you would think it's all the same in California, but not the case. Our community college district is consistently at the highest end of the pay scales among community colleges. So it's hard to leave here. We also have tenure, which means after so many years, you know, you get tenure and you're guaranteed your position, you know, unless you do something really, really bad. And that doesn't happen at the university level as far as coaching. Those are always 1 and possibly 2 year contracts, sometimes longer, but very rarely. And sometimes insurance and those type of packages aren't available. But at Mount SAC, they're part of our package. It's a great place where you can still have your life of your own, raise your family, and make a good salary and do a lot of good. As far as athletics at this level, I think it's a unique opportunity that a lot of people won't get. There's a unique opportunity at the community college to see if you can improve. And that opportunity is not given often at a Division I, where the coaches have only one thing, and they have to win. If they don't win, they get fired. Here, we have time to develop athletes, and that's been an interesting case here. Where, you know, would a Giovanni Lenaro, who became a 2-time Olympian here under us, been a 2-time Olympian had he not come to Mount SAC? Because he was a very, very mediocre pole vaulter out of high school. Would Adam Bianchessi, who never even did anything in high school nor junior high school, come out, become the national champion in javelin and earn a scholarship? Those opportunities probably wouldn't have been there had community college not been there. It's also an opportunity educationally to get ahead.
Yeah.
College, the best thing to think about community college is it's an opportunity to grow and to really grow and allow yourself to grow because of the class sizes, because of the opportunities, because of the programs that are available here. And it's also an opportunity to learn a profession. Some people may transfer, and some people may come in here and get a pilot's license and go on. Some people may come in and get an aircraft.
Oh, I was going to go somewhere. Thing.
Some people may welding. There's various opportunities to also learn a profession and move on, too. So it's a fulfilling part of a lot of community college programs, you know, whether it's Riverside, Mount Sachs, or you know, anywhere. Any of the community colleges have done a great job and have fulfilled a huge need in education. The thing about us is, like I said, the classroom sizes, we're low. Our teachers are teachers. That's the only thing they need to do. And I think one of the most important things is just the cost, because the cost at community colleges is far, far less than a USC or any other university. So, I mean, think about it. You go 2 years, you can buy yourself a brand new car. And at USC, you can buy yourself a Tesla, probably. Probably save $100,000 for here, you know. It's minimal. You know, a year's tuition with books and everything like that is $2,000 or less than that. So it's a huge bargain. Yeah, we have not just the nation. I think we've had people from all over the world. You know, because of the notoriety of Mount Sac and some of the things we do here, people come from all over the world, not just the nation.
I am a proponent of having fun while you're in school.
Yeah.
And because students pay $46 a unit at California community colleges, or they qualify for what is called a Board of Governors fee waiver, which the $46 is waived.
Wow.
And students can be 13 units, 20 units, whatever, and they pay $33.50 tuition, period.
If you prep yourself, you know exactly what you want to do, then you make a financial plan to do it, and you take the proper steps to get there, you know? It's really a matter of, I think when it comes to university and college, we're forced to make such a big decision. What do you want to do for the rest of your life? I know people who are coaches who are like 80 years old, they've done 10 different jobs, and then they concluded that, hell, I just want to pole vault for the rest of my day, I'm just going to go be a coach. So I think a junior college is a very competitively priced option for people who know what they want to do and how to get there. So, but I think what it really boils down to is you making the selection, really sitting down with yourself, asking the right questions, like, who am I? What do I want in my life? Do I need some time to figure that out? If you need a year after high school, go travel and find out more about yourself so that you can use more of your college education, that would be more deserving than trying to get into a big named university and saying, I'm from UCLA, I have no idea who I am. Additionally, what I want to say is so many kids are graduating university and being so confused about, like, what do I want in my life? And they don't have work experience. They have a business degree they have a BAs and whatever that they want that they chose in college, but that may not necessarily be what they want to do after college. And so I think a really good thing to do is during your time in college or university, doing internships and taking the time to get some work experience. So when you graduate, you're prepared. You have a better idea. Maybe I came into university wanting to be a chiropractor, and then after taking internship hours as nursing, first off, I have the work experience, so my resume is automatically more attractive than the guy who only has a graduate degree, you know? And second, I can take the experience that I have from nursing and be like, you know what, maybe I don't want to just be a chiropractor. I like that social aspect. Maybe I want to redirect myself to go do something in the medical field. So digressing back down to the point, know what you want to do. Take internships and figure out more about yourself. I think that's the best way to get the most out of your university experience, whether it be for college or university, college then university, or just college or just university.
One thing I've learned, you go out there and great experiment with this. Go ask 10 people, how are you doing? And the number one answer you're gonna get, I'm fine. 8 out of every 10 will come back with, I'm fine. And here's the part that I get nervous about when I think about it. Most people go through life numb. They don't allow themselves, when incredibly painful things happen, they don't give themselves permission in that moment to feel that pain and really just experience the deepness and the depth of that loss and hurt and all of that. And when you don't give yourself permission to do that, those situations in life that are the epitome of joy, you'll never appreciate it.
I agree.
Because you've never given yourself an opportunity to be here. So it's that old saying, as painful as it is, it's better to have loved and lost than to have loved at all. There is immense wisdom in that little statement, because the moment I felt this, you can no longer acknowledge that there is this thing called stability. I want that again. And when I get there, man, I'm going to appreciate it when I get to that level. And that life, people living and being able to be on that, is a phenomenal life to live. But most don't do that.
Until you've
Special thing for me here is that there's so many opportunities for the students, but you know, not just that, there's been a lot of opportunities for me, and it's been a great, for myself, it's been a tremendous opportunity to grow as a coach and to travel the world. I don't think I would have had that opportunity had I been at another university coaching. This environment allows me to grow, because I can work with anybody from high schoolers to our own college kids to elite athletes. And that's not possible at the Division I for a lot of different reasons. And here, for me, it's just been really fulfilling.
Nice. All the myths, they're only true if you make them true.
I agree.
You know, so
it's the experience, how you make it.
Yeah, you put in your work and you get your stuff done and you'll be fine.
If you come here, you really have to like work hard and have discipline, because if you don't, you're gonna fall off.
It's going to sound interesting, but I always feel like you end up where you're supposed to be. And if that means that you end up with letters that are rejection letters from schools, and you thought that's what was going to happen, and your path changes, that eventually you end up where you're supposed to be. If your path changes, kind of go with it. Know that there's a plan for you, and you'll be successful if you choose to be. I think that's the biggest thing, is it may not be the school you thought it was going to be. It may not be school at all. It may be a community college. It may be going and getting a job. But wherever your path takes you, if you have the determination to be successful, you will be.